And very often there's still this tendency of polarizing, you know? Of on the one hand having the people who say, oh, look, this is the traditional backward Indian ways of doing that we have to overcome with human rights, we have to civilize all these barbarian grassroots Indians or whatever. So that's one point of view, let's say, of the human rights activists. And then from the other point of view, we would have the people saying, why are all these things happening? Because the good old India with our respect of tradition is disappearing, and it's because these modern things are coming in and are creating chaos and there's no respect anymore, and so on and so on and so on. As long as you have this polarization of the debate, you know, on tradition is wonderful and modernity is bad, or modernity is wonderful and traditions are bad, well, you're missing the point of looking at what is actually going on and how in concrete situations you may just be able to find maybe more humane solutions. Knowing that they also, you know, it's not like when I'm saying more humane, not everybody will agree. We're always like in some power struggles. I may find that certain things are humane, somebody else may not find it. I mean, that's also what politics is about, you know? You find that you should be communist, the other guy finds you should be a capitalist, that's the life. But the important thing is to not shy away. I mean, that would be like my kind of message or what I was trying to do in my research and my teachings. Not to shy away from this complexity. Leave possibility for doubt. Leave the possibility to say, maybe we don't understand everything. We do not need to understand everything. We do not need to have like the theory which explains everything. But in a certain situation, what are the tools? There are modern tools. We have the tools of human rights. We have an Indian judiciary. We have even like a special commission for women's rights in India. We have all these things. How can we use it in a way that that makes sense? And also, we have traditions, we have things that we can rely on, we have like a alternative practices of law. Same thing. Again, what can we take from there? And I know it's very difficult in a certain way because usually, well, we don't want to have too many doubts, we rather want to have certainties, you know, and we want to have the perfect toolkit, like even in intercultural communication, you know, like to have the good communication,
like,
you know?
Simple.
But maybe what's important also is, do we little by little allow the time and allow ourselves to develop an attitude of listening, respecting, which then can also lead, see, with my Indian friends, sometimes I'm saying things, I know that I'm kind of shocking them a little, you know? But why can I do it? Because we have a relationship, see, it's the importance of relationship, it also takes time. You build up a relationship, there is some trust. And because we trust each other, because I accept their things, I respect their things, they start to respect us, what I'm saying.
Yes,
like, sometimes we don't agree exactly on what we are thinking, or we say, oh, okay, so I just keep it in my mind, and then maybe in one way or another, it still may have a certain influence. And so to come back, you know, to the what you were asking at the beginning on the human rights question, more generally speaking, it's the same thing, you know, it's like you have the discussion, then you just have to, I think it's really important to understand where people are. And I just remember for me, I told you, it was quite a few existential crises to come to the points of view that I have now. And it took me, I mean, I started to explicitly be interested in how do we perceive the world in relationship with language when I was like 10 years old. And it was 10 years old, maybe you have read that now, because I found out that communication students do learn that actually. For me, it was my childhood literature. I was reading all this like Paul Watzlawick.
Yes, yes.
That was when I was 10 years old, yes. That's what I was reading. That's what I enjoyed reading, you know, like how real is reality and all that kind of things. So, I mean, I've been really into that kind of, and then learning the Chinese martial arts, the Indian yoga, so also learning things in the way that they do it, you know? So, I mean, I've been doing lots of things in my whole life, and still it was so many challenges and existential crises. So, of course, I must also understand, you know, that I cannot take anybody, like, in one interview, or even if we have, like, a semester, I mean, you have had some of the classes with me, you just try to wake up something, you know, and hope that maybe for some people it will resonate a bit, you know, and then that trying to give at least some tools. That is why, for example, in our classes, I was talking about this alterity, complexity,
intentionality.
Why? It's just because at some points, you know, maybe even if you forget all the rest, there is something, oh, these things may in your own way help you to go your own path at a certain point. So that's what I would say.
Okay, thank you very much for the interview, and have a good day.
Thank you.